This morning, I'm going to be in Mark chapter 4 at the end. I'll invite you to turn there before I start, starting with verse 35. I'm going to be telling the story of Jesus and his miracles. I'm not going to give the scripture references. You'll have to follow along with me. And I'm going to call you throughout the service to respond. I'm going to ask you to raise your hands. I'm going to ask you to respond. And then at the very end, for those who feel God calling them and speaking to their heart, I'm going to ask you to respond by coming forward to meet Jesus today. But we'll get there. Are you in Mark chapter 4?
Yes.
Verse 35. It had been another long day for Jesus, full of preaching and teaching, of healing, of ministering. He was tired, and the Spirit was telling him it was time to go. He was standing in the boat, doing his thing, and finally he told his disciples, "Let's push off and go across to the other side." They made their way across, away from the crowds. A few small boats were following, and Jesus, being rocked by the waves, his humanity succumbed to sleep. As he was sleeping, the disciples crossing, a storm blew in. And those little waves that were lapping against started smacking against the boat and started crashing against the boat. And the wind started to blow. The rain was stinging the faces of the disciples. It was pelting their eyes. And these disciples, some of them seasoned seafaring men, were doing all they could to keep the boat afloat. The wind was threatening to capsize the boat. The waves were threatening to overpower the boat. And these men, having put down the sail, having grabbed out their oars, were doing their best just to survive. I don't know if you've ever been there before. Maybe not on the sea, but in life. I'm going to ask you to respond right now by raising your hand. How many of you have ever been in a storm of life before? I think we've all been there. Haven't we been in a storm of life of some sort or another? External forces pressing in on us, smacking us around, for us, you know, proverbially speaking, threatening to overpower us, threatening to capsize us. This is where the disciples were in real life, in the boat. But fortunately for them, Jesus was with them. But it wasn't until they turned to Jesus, it wasn't until they came to Jesus that he helped. He was still, amazingly, asleep in the stern of the boat. They turned to him, they woke him, they cried, "Lord, don't you even care that we perish?" Immediately, Jesus stood up and he addressed the wind and the waves. He commanded his power over the storm and he said, "Peace. Be still," and immediately the wind and the waves obeyed. Astonished, the disciples said, "Who is this man that even the wind and the waves obey him?" You know who this man is? This is the Jesus that we serve.
Amen.
How many of you this morning, maybe you are in a storm of life right now, and you say, "I want Jesus to fix my storm." It might not be a big storm, it might be a little storm, but you have something in your life. Maybe there's something that's turmoil in your family. Maybe your job is becoming intolerable for some reason. Maybe there's some sort of external thing that's happening that's either around you or nearby that is pressing up against you, that's causing turmoil in your life, that's causing disturbance in your life. Jesus can diffuse your disturbances.
Amen.
All you need to do is come to him. You don't even have to come in faith. These disciples had no faith, or at least very little faith. Jesus rebuked them. Let's read it here in verse 40. He said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have how much faith?"
No
faith. These guys didn't have any faith. "Don't you care, Jesus, that we perish?" But they still came to him. Friends, by the end of the sermon today, I'm going to invite you to come. Faith or no faith. This is the Jesus that we serve. He can diffuse your disturbances. Right after the storm was done, they reached the other side of the lake. And as soon as Jesus stepped out, Mark says, immediately a man approached him. A crazy man, matted hair, torn off clothes. His body was scarred and scabbed and scratched from all the abuse that he had done to himself. No one could contain this man. No one could help this man. The chains that bound him, he had broken. The shackles that were clung to him, he broke. He was running through the tombs, naked and alone and helpless, a demoniac. The demons in his life had taken over. And there he was, just like the disciples, coming to Jesus. Instead of asking, "Don't you even care, Jesus?" he said, "Jesus, what do I have to do with you? Please, don't torment me." This was like less than faith. This was like, "Jesus, get away from me." What kind of a turmoil must have been going on inside of this man? Listen, I've never been demon-possessed. I don't know if anyone here has ever dabbled in demonic forces. But imagine what this man must have been going through. Maybe you have internal demons. That voice in your head that's been speaking for years. Maybe somebody had been putting these thoughts in your mind. You're not good enough. You're not smart enough. You're not worthy. Maybe you try to do your best. And for some reason in your mind, the demons tell you it's not good enough. You'll never be good enough. Maybe in your life, you struggle with the internal demons of a negativity. You're always thinking negative thoughts and speaking negativity. Maybe you verbally lash out at people when they don't do what you like. And you wish that you could do better, but you can't. And there's this struggle there. How many of us have ever faced demons in our life? If not being possessed by demons, some internal demons that are just making us do things we don't want to do, even to hurt ourselves. How many of us have faced that kind of thing before in our life? This man was in that kind of a situation. Jesus responded to the demons and he said, "You leave this man now." And then he asked him a question, "What's your name?" speaking to the demon. The demon replied, "Legion, for we are many." "Please, don't torment us, don't make us leave the country. Let us enter into the swine." There was a herd of 2,000 swine nearby. Jesus told them to leave, and they left. They entered the swine, and the man, he must have just collapsed into Jesus' arms like they took his bones with them. When the others saw what happened to this man, they saw that he was clear of mind. They saw that he was open-eyed. Jesus can make a difference in your life. Jesus is the miracle worker. We need miracles in our life. I'm talking about divine intervention in our lives. How many of us this morning, I'm going to ask you to respond again. How many of you this morning want divine intervention in your life? You want God to come into your life and do something. You might be saying, "I can't face this storm, all these external pressures. Jesus, I need your help." He will help you. He will diffuse your disturbances and say, "Peace, be still." He will turn your demons into dust. And you can be set free. This isn't the power of positive thinking. This is a savior. Amen. This isn't internal strength. This is divine strength. Amen. This is the Jesus that we serve. Amen. And if you want that this morning, you can come to Jesus. Jesus wasn't able to stay there long. The people who lost all that money from all those swine because those demons ran them right off the cliff, they came and said, Jesus, get out of here, please, just leave. Imagine that Jesus came all the way across that lake. He went through the storm just for that one person. Can you believe that? The Spirit knew what was going to happen ahead of time. The Spirit told Jesus, go across the lake. He obeyed the Spirit. He went across the lake just for one person. Just to set one person free. If Jesus did that for him, he will do it for you. He has moved heaven and earth to make sure that you have all of your needs supplied. To make sure that he can work divinely in your life. He has been freed from Satan's accusations. He's been freed from any sort of call that the devil had against Jesus, accusing him of something. And Jesus is free to work in your life today. He has victory over demons. He has victory over the storms of your life. He has victory over death, the grave, hell, everything else. And all we need to do is come. Getting back in the boat, Jesus had to cross back across the lake. And as soon as he got there, the throngs were there, ready to engulf him again. Shoulders were bumping together. Voices were calling. Jesus was being led by a ruler of the synagogue named Jairus to Jairus' house because his little girl was sick, about to die. Jesus was going to go help. As he was moving through the crowds, one woman who'd been burdened with a disease for 12 years. She tried to make her way through the crowd to Jesus. She couldn't talk to him face to face. There's no way that he would have heard her call above all the crowd. She said to herself, if only, I don't even have to talk to him. If only I can touch the hem of his garment. If I can just touch his clothes, I will be healed. This woman had faith. Reminds me of the centurion soldier. At another time, Jesus met a centurion soldier and he said, just say the word and he'll be healed, speaking to about his servant. Just say the word, Jesus. And this woman said, if only I just touch the hem of his garment. I don't even have to talk to him. He doesn't even have to agree to it. This man has power. This is the Jesus that we serve. Amen. She was afflicted with disease. Maybe you have internal problems. Maybe you've got some sort of, it's not internal demons, it's not external. Maybe you've got, maybe you've been feeling on your skin and there's a lump on your skin and you're afraid it might be cancer. Maybe you've got chronic back pain. Maybe you've got arthritis. This woman had an issue of blood, the Bible says, for 12 years. She'd spent all of her money, everything that she had to try to get better, but only got worse. But she came to Jesus for help. And so can you. You know, some of us are younger people, I mean, we may not have as many health ailments. Some of us are up in age and have had more time to accumulate some of this stuff. But if you have some of those in your life, younger or older, Jesus can heal you. We don't know how old this woman was. She touched the hem of his garment, and immediately she felt the difference. She was healed, and Jesus felt the difference too. He said, who touched me? I don't know if the disciples were confused or maybe smirked a little bit and said, Jesus, what do you mean who touched you? Look at all these people that have been bumping around you and clamoring after you. No, Jesus said. Somebody touched me with the touch of faith. Power has gone out of me. The woman who couldn't contain herself anymore, partly because she'd been healed, and partly because she was being called by Jesus when he said, who touched me? Spoke up and told him everything. And then you can read with me in chapter 5, verse 34. Jesus said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your affliction. He brings peace to the storm. He brings peace to your heart. And he can bring peace to your spirit and your soul as well, to your whole body. Who wants healing from Jesus this morning? Who wants to meet this man today? You may know him already. I'm not asking for you to say, I'm going to accept Jesus into my heart for the first time. I'm saying, how many of us here this morning want to have a meeting with Jesus? How many of us here this morning want to say, Jesus, come into my life right now and touch me. I need healing. I need physical healing. Jesus can do that. As Jesus was talking with this woman, a servant came up to Jairus and told him the bad news that his daughter was dead. This little girl couldn't come to Jesus. She was sick. She couldn't have faith in Jesus. She was dead. She needed somebody else to have faith for her.
Amen.
She needed her father to walk with his feet to Jesus and come to Jesus on her behalf and say, Lord, my daughter, please, please, my daughter. Jesus understood this, and he told him after he heard what the servant had said in verse 36, do not be afraid, Jairus, only believe. Imagine Jesus thinking or saying, Jairus, your daughter needs you to believe right now. They continued to the house. As they get closer, you could hear it. The sound of the wailing, the sound of the mourning, the paid mourners crying out because the girl was dead, the family crying out because the girl was dead. Jesus, walking through the crowd, entered the house, and he put everyone out, only the mother and the father. Jesus and his three closest disciples, Peter, James, and John, were there with him. They closed the door behind them. They went into the room where the little girl's lifeless body lay limp. Jesus immediately walked over, took her frail little hand, and spoke his power into her life, even in death. Little girl, arise! And immediately she arose. You know, this servant didn't understand when he said to Jairus that the little girl was dead. He said, why bother the master anymore? Why bother the teacher anymore? He didn't know what we know. He didn't know that Jesus could diffuse the disturbances. He didn't know that Jesus could turn the demons into dust. The servant didn't know that Jesus could take the disease and vanquish it away. And he didn't know that Jesus could even defy death. But we do. Do you believe that Jesus can work miracles today? He can. He can work miracles. Matter of fact, he wants to work miracles. The Bible tells us in James that we don't have certain things simply because we do not ask. The disciples came to Jesus. This demoniac came to Jesus. This woman with the issue of blood came to Jesus, just touched the hem of his garment. But this little girl, she couldn't come to Jesus. She needed somebody to come for her. I believe Jesus can work miracles in your life today. He loves you and he wants to do things for you. He has power to do good things in your life. So I'm going to ask you, if you think that Jesus can work miracles today, there might be people here who don't know that maybe they have faith and they're saying, my faith isn't strong enough to believe that. And they need your faith, like this little girl needed faith of her father. If you believe that Jesus can work miracles, I want you to just stand where you are. Just say, yes, I believe Jesus works miracles. This is to show other people who maybe need that faith. Yes, Jesus can work miracles. You are the people that have the faith for others. You are special people because you know something and believe something that's true that other people may not believe or know. And then I have some calls to call you forward today, and I'm going to make them specific calls. And you can come forward. What you're saying is, Jesus, I'm coming to you. And here's what they are. Just like the people, the disciples who were in that storm, you may have things beating against you. Whatever it is, you have things that are just from the outside, just pummeling you. And you say, Jesus, I want your help. I can't do this. Maybe you're even a seasoned wayfaring or a seafaring man like these disciples were, and you say, I've been around for a while. I've done this before, but I'm just overwhelmed. if you want Jesus in your life because you want him to take care of that stuff out there, I just invite you to come down to the front and just say, Jesus, take charge this morning. Just come on down. You may be somebody like the demoniac. You may be possessed by a demon, or you may just have these demons in your mind telling you you're not good enough, telling you that you're not strong enough, telling you that you'll never win, you'll never accomplish anything, you're not worthy of God's love or whatnot. I invite you to come down and say, Jesus, I need you to dispel the demons in my life. I need you to turn the demons into dust. I need you to vanquish them away. If you have that internal thing going on, Jesus can fix it. Just by coming down, you're just saying, yes, Lord Jesus, work in my life. You might be like this woman who had something wrong with her body, a physical ailment, something going on inside of you. Either you know what it is or you don't know what it is. You've had it for a long time, or this is something brand new. It doesn't matter to Jesus. He can take care of it. You don't have to wait 12 years. You can come to him today, and I invite you to come down to the front and just say, Jesus, I come as I am and ask you to take care of my body. Take my disease and defy the disease. And there's probably some of you out there, you say, you know, I don't have physical ailments. I don't really struggle with internal demons. Nothing's really pressing me from the outside right now. But you know somebody in your life who is struggling. They're struggling with something. And you are the person that can intercede on their behalf. They may not even know Jesus or be able to come to him, but you can come on their behalf, not for yourself, but you can come to Jesus and say, Jesus, I bring before you my sister. I bring before you my mom. I bring before you my coworker, my classmate. These are the people, whoever it is in your mind, you say, Jesus, I come on their behalf. Friends, Jesus can make a difference even in their life, just like this little girl, because of the faith of her father, because her father came. And here you are standing today, either because you have storms in your life, or you have demons in your life, or because you have internal problems with your body, or because somebody else needs help. And you're coming to Jesus, and Jesus is ready to help. You just bow your heads with me, and I'm going to pray a prayer. You can pray in your heart as well, and it's simply this. Lord Jesus, you're the mighty healer, you're the miracle worker. We need your might and power in our lives. Lord, we come on behalf of others who need your might and power. Some of us today are caught in the storm of life, Lord. Diffuse our disturbances. Some of us are facing demons in our life, Lord. Turn our demons into dust. Some of us are facing physical ailments today, Lord. Turn our illness into wellness by your power. Some of us have come on behalf of others, touch their lives that the lifeless may live again. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Sing with me.
Thank you.
in the Sabbath school class with the cradle roll, does the scripture memory verse paraphrase for children is this: be kind to one another. You know, God loves you so much. And you look around and you see people who need kindness. God has been kind to us, amen?
Amen.
He's promising us help, hope, and healing. And we can share that hope and help with others. And we can intercede that God would fulfill the healing as well. That's the good word for today. I invite you to just turn around and leave here expecting that God will do something.